All right, we're going to be in Exodus chapter 18 this morning, and we're going to notice about Jethro. And for the sake of the recording, it messed up, and I'm going to have to repeat some things. We're going to notice about the wise father-in-law of Jethro. I say wise because when I say Jethro, many people are going to think of Jethro Bodine from the Beverly Hillbillies, who was often called a dunderhead. And as I made a little joke earlier, that this Jethro that we read about in the Bible, who's not related to Jed Clampett in any way, his last name was not Bodine, and he was certainly not a dunderhead. He is very wise, and we're going to notice his wisdom this morning. He's going to give Moses some indispensable advice. Starting in verse 1 says, "When Jethro, the priest of Midian, Moses' father-in-law, heard of all that God had done for Moses and for Israel, his people, and the Lord had brought Israel out of Egypt, then Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, took Zipporah, Moses' wife, after he had sent her back, and her two sons, which of the name of the one was Gershom, for he said, I have been an alien in a strange land, and the name of the other was Eleazar, for the God of my father, said he, was mine help, and delivered me from the sword of Pharaoh. Now at an earlier unspecified time and unspecified reason, Moses sent Zipporah, Gershom, and Eleazar back to his father-in-law, Jethro." Now many thoughts as to why and to when it happened, and scholars have debated this, and it falls into the realm of whether Adam had a belly button or not. What color was Eve's hair? What type of fruit was of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil? We don't know. All we know is that it happened. Now some say it happened, he sent them back to protect them from Egypt. Now this would make sense that when you're going up against essentially the world superpower, and you're gonna wind up making Pharaoh angry, and they have the Egyptian army after them. Well, you could kind of understand one of the safety. Then some say it happened after the circumcision incident, where Zipporah literally had to take matters into her own hands and circumcise her sons, because Moses didn't do it. But regardless, and of course we can understand why that he would send them back after that. He would be afraid of her. And this actually makes the least sense to me. According to what I was studying on it, they were saying that he sent her back because he was afraid of her usurping the authority. Now, her taking matters into her own hands because he wouldn't, and then that happening, it seems off. It seems off. I tend to be more in the camp that he sent them back to protect them from Pharaoh and from the Egyptian police and military. I know if I was going into battle, I wouldn't want to take Brandon and Brittany with me. That's just one of those things. I mean, for what it's worth, even though Brittany is younger and I'm going to say stronger than my dad, as dad, I mean, you're up there in age. I'm just, you know, facts. She's in the prime of youth and you're up there in age. But I still prefer to take you into battle over her, because we have Brand. And she's my wife. I mean, even if we didn't have Brand, I'd want to leave her behind, because that I would want her protected. I wanted her to live. That's how any husband should be. And so I tend to be more in that camp. But regardless of the reason why, regardless of when it happened, the Bible doesn't tell us. And then furthermore, it's unimportant to the point that's being made in the chapter here. We just need to know that it happened. And then verse 5 says, "Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, came with his sons and his wife unto Moses into the wilderness, where he encamped at the Mount of God. And he said unto Moses, I, thy father-in-law, Jethro, am come unto thee, and thy wife and her two sons with her. And Moses went out to meet his father-in-law, and did obeisance, and kissed him. And they asked each other of their welfare, and they came into the tent." So we see this friendly opening up here. They're glad to see each other. They ask each other of their welfare. He invited him into the tent. And I want to take note of this term obeisance here. The term obeisance can mean to worship, but it can also mean to prostrate yourself or to bow yourself down before either God or royalty. Now, the Jehovah's Witnesses love to try to use this to, they love to change the word around to try to take away from the divinity of Christ. But they run into other problems regarding that. But Moses did obeisance. He didn't worship Jethro, but he bowed down. He showed respect. It was a sign of respect that he did to his father-in-law. And you have to remember that Jethro, he wasn't just Moses' father-in-law. If you remember, he was the priest of Midian. And Moses highly respected his father-in-law. He highly respected Jethro. And then Jethro also brought Moses' family with him back to Moses. So, I mean, this is a really happy bond here between the two of them. They respect each other. You remember, it was Moses that saved Jethro's daughter from the men at the well when they were trying to murder the father's flocks. So it's like they had this really cool mutual respect going on. And that's the thing about it is we need to always remember that we need to always remember that we need to love and respect our in-laws because they are our spouse's parents. You know, I mean, they had to do something, right? But the term obeisance here means that it's with here from one man to another. Of course, it's not worship. It is that Moses is showing respect to Jethro because Jethro was his father-in-law. He was wise. He was the priest of Midian. Then on into verse 8. Let me find my spot again. Verse 8. And Moses told his father-in-law all that the Lord had done unto Pharaoh, to the Egyptians for Israel's sake, and all the travail that had come upon them by the way, and how the Lord delivered them. And I want y'all to notice here what Jethro says. What Jethro does, what he says. And Jethro rejoiced for all the goodness which the Lord had done unto Israel, whom he had delivered out of the hand of the Egyptians. And Jethro said, Blessed be the Lord who hath delivered you out of the hand of the Egyptians and out of the hand of Pharaoh, who hath delivered the people from under the hand of the Egyptians. Now I know that the Lord is greater than all gods. For in the thing wherein they dealt proudly, he was above them. Now Jethro, he was ecstatic. He was happy. I know. Jethro was ecstatic. He was happy to hear all the good that the Lord did for Moses and for Israel. And many look at verse 11 and they don't think much of it. They just read past it. But that's one of those things. When you're studying for a sermon, certain things just jump out at you. And this was one of those verses that really jumped out at me. It's curious that in the grander picture how that God has dealt with man and offers greater insight into something that occurs thousands of years into human history. And it even affects us today. Okay? And before you're scratching your head, like, what? Let me tell about this. How that it's curious that in the grander picture of him dealing with man, he offers this insight. First, let's go back last week. I'm sure that everybody remembers last week. If you don't remember last week, you need to go back and watch the sermon. If you remember last week, how we talked that God sees only two kinds of people, Christians and sinners, believers, unbelievers, saint, sinner, he only sees two types. Those covered by the blood of Christ and those not covered by the blood of Christ. And if you remember how we noticed that the blessings found in Christ are exclusive to those in Christ. Well, we have another lesson here in exclusivity. This is one of those things that I'm really loving about Exodus. You see, you have Genesis. You have Genesis, which deals with the creation account. You have the Noah flood. There's so, if I could sum up Genesis in one word, it would be obedience to God. Think about it. You have the theme of Genesis is not just the beginning. The theme of Genesis is obedience. You have in the Garden of Eden, what did God tell them to do? Not eat of the fruit of the tree, the knowledge of good and evil. What do? They disobeyed God. They got punished for it. Man's heart was continually wicked by chapter 6. And God tells Noah to build the ark. What does he do? He thus did Noah according to all that God commanded him. He obeyed God. And he was saved. Then you have the thing with Abraham. When God told him to offer his son Isaac, what did Abraham do? He obeyed. Then you had the thing that happened with Lot. Sodom and Gomorrah were punished. What for? Their disobedience. Lot was spared. Lot and his family were spared. Why? Because Lot was obedient. And that just is the start of it. You go all throughout the book of Genesis and you have time after time after time of these people that we read about, that they are either rewarded or punished for their obedience or disobedience. But then what do we have in Exodus here? What is the theme of Exodus? If y'all haven't caught on to the theme of Exodus, I really want y'all to catch on to the theme of Exodus. There is one word that really sums up the theme of Exodus. And that term, that one word, is exclusivity. What did God do when He brought the plagues upon Egypt? He wasn't just setting His people free. He was showing exclusively that He is the one true God. He was showing that He is far above anything that man can come up with. When you have the Israelites, what they're doing, He's showing them going through the wilderness and everything, Him caring for them. He's showing the exclusive care He has for His chosen people at the time. And then notice, later on, when we're really close. If y'all don't understand what's going on, they're here at the Mount of God. We are very close to the Ten Commandments. And if you remember, the first commandment is, "Thou shalt have no other gods before me." The whole theme of Exodus is not just the Exodus, but the theme of Exodus is the exclusivity of God and the exclusivity of His people. And so notice here what Jethro said. Jethro said that the Lord is greater than all gods. But even Jethro here was mistaken about something. He was mistaken about something. What now? What is he mistaken about? What is Jethro mistaken about? I'm going to tell you what Jethro was mistaken about. You fast forward to Exodus 20. You have one of the Ten Commandments. There in verse 3. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. We just noticed that. But then, before we go too much further, there's a quick side note. Many like to look back at the Ten Commandments as the top ten, like they're more important than the others. And the problem with this logic is found in James 2. James 2 says, if you're guilty of one, you're guilty of all. The problem with seeing the Ten Commandments as a top ten is that they're not a top 10. They're not the 10 biggies. They are a foundation upon which the other commandments in the Old Testament are built. They are the foundation of God's law to the Israelites. His other commandments are built upon that. For example, you have the command for them to honor the Sabbath day and keep it holy. Remember that? Then later on in the Old Testament, especially the book of Leviticus, when we get into that, you're going to get into a lot of the sacrificial laws, the laws regarding worship, all this that was supposed to take place when? On the Sabbath day. So, what you have going on is you have the Ten Commandments set up as a foundation upon which the other laws are built. Similarly, we have two foundational commandments in the New Testament. Those two foundational commandments in the New Testament, and let's find them real quick, because I don't want to just tell them. I want to read them. Matthew 22. It's in Matthew 22. Starting verse 34 says, when the Pharisees heard that he had put the Sadducees to silence, they were gathered together. Then one of them, which was a lawyer, asked him a question, tempting him, saying, Master, which is the great commandment of the law? Now, this is actually the foundation of the entire Bible, but especially the foundation of the New Testament. He said, Master, which is the great commandment in the law? And Jesus said unto him, verse 37, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. The second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Now that's in the Old Testament that he's talking about there when they're asking that question. But, which is, you know, those are the two foundational laws of it all. But you have the Ten Commandments was really the foundational law of the Old Testament in regards to Israel, the physical nation. But we have these foundational laws of love God with all you have and love your neighbor as yourself. Those are the foundations of the complete Bible. Those are our foundational laws in the New Testament. In fact, Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. I believe that's John 14:15, if I remember correctly. I may be wrong. That you could look it up. But I know that that is there. In fact, let me. I don't like being. Yes, if you love me, keep my commandments. I hit that spot on. I'm actually very surprised. Generally, my strength is in knowing the concepts. And being able to properly apply the concepts, not remember exactly where a verse is. I'm surprised I hit that spot on. If you love me, keep my commandments. John 14:15. But that's just a quick side note right there. Getting back to our main point of exclusivity here. In Acts 17:30, you have this whole thing that... rewind a little bit to Jethro here. He's talking about God being greater than the gods. Well, where he is mistaken a little bit is where that a lot of people are mistaken about stuff today. Now, the reason why the folks are mistaken is because of is not so much the exclusivity, but they think in terms not of exclusivity, but of greater or less. You see, back then, Jethro considered it like a pie chart. He considered it like a pie chart. most people back then considered the gods like a pie chart. That you have all these gods, and the one that they worship is the greatest out of all the rest of them. The rest of them are lesser gods. So when he said that, Jethro said in verse 11, "Now I know that the Lord is greater than all gods," he wasn't saying so much that Jehovah God is the one true God of heaven. He was saying that he was greater than the rest of them. But we know that this was that time of ignorance that God winked at. When you go back to Acts 17:30, Paul spoke of these times of ignorance that God winked at. These are those times of ignorance. But like, once again, we looked at what the ignorance was. The ignorance was that God was greatest among many gods. Now I said that the problem is similar and very familiar to today. And the reason why is because, like I said, people view it like a pie chart or a pie graph. Excuse me. You see, the earlier problem that we talked about, when we noticed about the Ten Commandments just a little bit ago, is people view them as being greater, you know, greater or less. And when you view the Ten Commandments as being the top ten or greater than the others, not so much as a foundational, but greater than the others in scope, then or importance rather, in scope of importance, then you have to imply that the rest of them are less. And remember what we talked about in Bible class about how that people like to rank sin. Well, just like people like to rank sin, compare little white lies to big lies. No, it's just lies. And in Revelation, we know that all liars will have their part in the lake that burns with fire and brimstone. For example, in the Old Testament, there is a passage concerning homosexuality in Leviticus that says it's an abomination. But then you have in the Ten Commandments nothing about homosexuality. Does that mean that God's law of homosexuality is less than His law of like keeping the Sabbath in the Old Testament, or about committing adultery, or coveting your neighbor's property? No, it's still, if you violate God's law, you violate God's law. And so the problem, the way that it all comes around, it's not that God is greater than the other gods, nor are they lesser. That's right, I just sat here in the pulpit and said that God is not greater than the other gods, nor are they lesser. Now, before you get ready to cast me out and stone me for preaching false doctrine, let me explain why this whole mentality is not really the problem. The problem is not that there's no difference in greatness or greatness between the gods. The whole thing is that the other gods, these so-called lesser gods, they don't exist. There's nothing to them because they're made up. Like, for example, you have the Canaanite god Baal. In the Old Testament, when Israel would fight Canaan, the Canaanite people, or the Palestinians, or the Philistines rather, excuse me, and they would be worshiping Baal, they would view it as two gods going against each other, and the greater of the gods would win. The problem with that line of thinking is not thinking that one is greater or less than the other. The problem with the line of thinking is assuming that Baal is a god. He's an idol. He's made up. He's nothing. There is only one true God. And Paul reveals this to us in chapter 17 of the book of Acts, starting in verse 22. Let's go and let's read it. It says, "Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, Ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things ye are too religious." Or the King James says superstitious. "For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, your worship, I found an altar with this inscription, To the unknown God." He basically said, they are so religious that they even have an altar to the gods that they don't know about. Okay, so continue on. And verse 23 says, "Whom therefore ye ignorantly worship, him I declare unto you, God that made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands, neither is he worshipped with men's hands as though he needed anything, seeing he giveth to all life, breath, and all things, and hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on all the face of the earth, and hath determined the times before appointed, the bounds of their habitation, that they should seek the Lord, if haply they might feel after him and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as certain also of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring. For as much as we are the offspring of God, we ought not think that the Godhead is like unto gold, silver." Now here, verse 29, pay attention. "For as much as we then are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold or silver or stone, graven by art and man's device." Okay, we're going to notice one word real quick here. The term device. The term device is not talking about a device like my cell phone is a device. The term device is enthumesis. And it's it means deliberation or thought. In other words, he's saying we don't need to think of the Godhead like the idols that you make, because the idols that you make, that you carve out of, and that you make out of gold and silver and stone, they're of your own imagination. But the God that I'm declaring unto you is real. And then he tells in verse 30, the times of this ignorance. What times of this ignorance? We just looked at it. The times of thinking that the other gods were anything and that one God is greater than another. All that. That's the times of ignorance. God winked at that. How do we know he winked at it? And he didn't ignore it. He winked at it. What did he wink at? What did he wink at? He winked at, we go back to Exodus chapter, to the Ten Commandments, when God said, thou shalt have no other gods before me. You go back to where we are here in Exodus chapter 18, verse 11, where Jethro said, now I know that the Lord is greater than the gods, is greater than all gods. That's the times of ignorance. The times of ignorance was not just, oh, there's gods and we get to worship however we want to worship. No, God has never allowed any man to put him in second place. God, just because God wants first place in our lives doesn't mean that he will settle for second best. Okay, he's not going to settle for second place. He's not going to settle for second best. Either he comes first or he doesn't come at all. And so, but God knew that people back then were ignorant. They were ignorant. They thought that he was the greatest about, and he, for the Israelites, that they thought that he was the greatest out of the pantheon. of all the various gods. And he's like, okay, as long as they put me first, I'm going to let a lot of this thinking slide. But it's not going to last forever. Because he expected people to grow up and come to the realization that he is the one true God of heaven, and outside of him there is no other God. So verse 30, the times of this ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent. Because he hath appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained, whereof he hath given assurance unto all men, and that he hath raised him from the dead. Paul's whole point there was telling them that the Greek gods, the Philistine gods, all the gods of the past were nothing but figments of the man's imagination, and that there is one true God. And it is in that one true God that we have life. And it is that one true God that will judge us in the last day. The theme of Exodus is exclusivity, and we see how it ties in with the New Testament there. And in the New Testament, we see that there's one Lord, one faith, one baptism. We see that there's one head of the church. We see that there is one church. And there's identification marks, certain DNA identification marks of the church. I don't want to get too far into that because we need to stick here in Exodus. But the whole thing... In fact, let's do talk a little bit about the church. See, many people think that there's many paths going to heaven. They like to lump the Church of Christ in with other denominations. They like to view us as just part of many. People view the church. You don't get it a whole lot. People. This is really hard because I'm trying to explain a concept here that many people just they don't get. People like to view the church the same way that people in the Old Testament viewed Jehovah God. They viewed him as part of a greater pantheon of gods that he is merely the greatest of. But Paul's argument in the New Testament is that pantheon doesn't exist. There is only one God. All the rest of them are merely figments of man's imagination. And people view the church the same way. They view churches of Christ the same way. They like to lump us in with all the rest of the churches, all the rest of them. And I'm using that term the way that they use it. And then there are people within the churches of Christ that merely view us as being greater than the rest of them. If we follow the same line of logic with Paul, the same line of reasoning that Paul gave with God, then we come to a much better understanding that the church is not simply a greater part of a pie. And many people like to oversimplify things and say that we think that we're the only ones going to heaven. It's a stupid argument. Why? Because exclusivity. The Bible makes it plain. Ephesians 5:22-33 and Revelation 21:9. Let's take a look at these passages real quick. Normally I don't do this much going throughout the scriptures, but this chapter calls for it. Ephesians 5 starting in verse 22. Okay, Ephesians 5:22. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let wives be subject to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church. Dave. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church, and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. So ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself. For no man ever yet hated his own flesh, but nourisheth and cherisheth it, even as the Lord the church. For we are members of his body, of his flesh, of his bones. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother, and shall be joined unto his wife, and they two shall be one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let every one of you in particular so love his wife as himself, and the wife see that she reverence her husband. Throughout that whole passage here, we don't find the word churches anywhere. We find the singular, church. And I go back to what we have the picture here of the bride and the groom, husband and wife. We go back, we look at what Jesus said in Matthew 19. He said, in the beginning he made them male and female, and the two shall be one flesh. We have it reiterated here. From the beginning, God's plan for the home was one man and one woman being joined until death. And the whole point behind that, and any deviation, two men, two women, multiple men, multiple husbands, multiple wives, polygamy is a deviation, adultery is a deviation, any deviation violates the type. What is the type? What is the picture of? And what is the antitype? Well, you have the picture. Marriage is like that of Jesus and the church. Dad, how many husbands does mom have? Go ahead and speak. How many husbands?
One.
How many wives do you have?
One.
Okay, one and one. The two are made one flesh. And Paul just said that it's being of the church. And then when you go over to Revelation 21:9, let's go over there real quick. Now I know Revelation has a lot of symbolism and stuff, but this is one of those, I love this verse here, because there is symbolism in here, but it's symbolism we can understand. It says, there came unto me one of the seven angels, which had seven vials full of the seven last plagues, and talked with me, saying, come hither, I will show thee the bride. Now, who is the bride? The Lamb's wife. Who is the Lamb? The Lamb is Jesus. Now, the thing is, my dad was just saying that. It's like, I have one wife. My dad has one wife. Our wives have one husband. And we have identification marks. That's how we identify. That's how we identify our spouses. That will do the identification marks. If they go and they change everything, then they're no longer our spouse. And we're not talking about getting a new haircut. It's like, how do I know? It's like, okay, I know Brittany is my spouse. She's my wife. Well, how do I know her from every other woman out on the planet? Well, she's different than every other woman out on the planet. She has her own unique personality. She has her own unique talents. She has her own unique, you know, the way she talks, her eye color, everything about her. She is unique. She is separate than every other woman on the planet. And I have one legitimate wife. Any other woman who comes up claiming to be my spouse, their claim is invalidated. If any other husband, if any other man comes up claiming to be her husband, their claims are invalidated. Why? Because they are not me. And so we have the same picture here with the church, the exclusivity. Oversimplifying it by saying that people in the Church of Christ think they're the only ones going to heaven, that's a stupid argument, and I'm so sick and tired of hearing it. You go back, you look at Ephesians 5:22-33, you go to Revelation 21:9, the church is painted as the picture as the bride of Christ. And any other group, any other Lord, any other God, just anything that wants to make any claim, it's the claim is automatically invalidated. And the same way that I know my wife, Jesus knows the church. And this is the thing that people don't understand. It's not about, oh, we think we're the only ones going to heaven. That's a stupid argument. It's used to try to shut people up. It's made to have a chilling effect on the conversation. We need to move past that argument. We need to move past this argument. Denominations. I call on every single denomination to move past that argument. It's a stupid argument. Instead, let's look at it. How many wives does someone have? It's supposed to be one wife. One husband, one wife. We have the picture of it. It's Christ in the church. How many Christ? One. How many churches? One. And Jesus, just as you know your wife because there are things about her that make her unique, and she knows you because there are certain things about you that make you unique, Jesus knows the church and the church knows Jesus. And what are the ideas? It's like Brittany has identification marks. I was able to tell her apart. It's not just circular reasoning going on here. And I'm not just repeating things to repeat things. You get down to it, what's one of the identification marks of the church? Now, most people think, oh, I'm going to start talking about instrumental music or the name or anything like that. No, I'm going to go completely out of left field here. What is one of the identification marks of the church? Well, you go to Acts 20 and verse 7. They met upon the first day of the week, where the disciples came together to break bread, the Lord's Supper. They partook of the Lord's Supper every first day of every week. And you have groups out there that want. Do you have groups out there that want to take the Lord's Supper semi-annually, sometimes annually, sometimes bi-monthly, all these different things like that, and they want to call themselves a church? Well, they're not meeting the identification mark. My wife, Brittany, she knows how to draw. I remember when she drew a funny picture up on the board of a game that we like to play, Skyrim. You remember when you drew Balgriff up on the board? Yeah, she remembers it. My wife knows how to draw. She knows how to draw really good. She's one of the best artists that I've ever seen, and I'm not just obligated to say that because she's my wife. She really is one of the best artists I've ever seen. And I know that there's people that will agree with. That's one of her identification marks. If a woman comes up claiming to be my wife, and her definition of art is drawing a stick figure with squiggly lines for hair, then I know that's not my wife. Why? Because my wife knows how to draw. The example given for the church in the New Testament is that they partake of the Lord's Supper every first day of the week. Every Sunday, every first day of the week, they partake of the Lord's Supper. And then you have some group that wants to take it once a year, going up wanting to call themselves the church. Jesus is going to say to them on the last day? You know what Jesus is even saying to them through His Word today? He's saying, you call yourself the church, you're calling yourself my spouse, but you are not my spouse. My spouse partakes of the Lord's Supper every first day of the week. You're doing it once a year. Talk about the instrumental music. What do we have in the New Testament? Sing. It says sing. Every time that this comes to making music in the New Testament and worship to God, the thing it is said is singing. Singing. And then you have groups that want to add in all sorts of instrumental music and rock bands and light shows and everything like that, and they want to call themselves the church? Tell you what Jesus is saying to them, saying to his word, you call yourself my wife, you call yourself my bride, but you are not my bride. How do I know? Because the identification marks. My bride sings, doesn't put on a rock show. We're talking about, I'm about to really get some folks upset right now. You know why? Because I'm about to bring some up. We're talking about in Bible class. We're talking about Catholicism in Bible class. Yes, we're talking about Catholicism in Bible class. And I'm really going to jump on them right now, because the Catholics, they say that they are the one true Church of Christ. You know what Jesus is going to do what Jesus is saying to them through his word? He says, you call yourself my wife, and yet my people call no man father on earth, because there is one Father who is in heaven. And yet you have some dude walking around claiming to be me, sitting on a golden throne, calling himself Papa. Pope. That doesn't sound like my wife. And if I seem angry right now, it's righteous indignation. It's a righteous indignation, and we have every right to be angry. I know, Brittany, that you can't speak because of 1 Timothy 2, but just nod your head yes or no. If there are other women coming up to me claiming to be my spouse, claiming to be my wife, would that make you angry? Yes or no? Yes, it would make you angry. Of course, I understand their claims are invalidated. I understand that they're illegitimate. You understand that they're illegitimate and that their claims are invalidated. We both understand that, but it still makes you angry. It still makes you angry because you're jealous. You're a jealous spouse. Rightfully so. You have one husband, and you claim him for yourself. Same way that I have one wife and claim her for myself. If there's other men coming up trying to claim that they are Brittany's husband, then I'm sorry, I might stop this video and we're going to have to go outside and have words. And there might be some fist flying. Because that Irish blood in me. Yeah. Yeah. You see, that's why I get so passionate, so angrily passionate about this whole thing, because you have other groups. We are the bride of Christ, and there's other groups trying to make that claim. No! That ain't gonna fly. And then you have people that are part, that are supposed to be exclusive. We're supposed to be exclusive. We are the bride of Christ. We are exclusive. And you have people that are within the bride of Christ, within the Church of Christ, and people outside and inside trying to lump us all together. With Catholics, Pentecostals, Baptists, Presbyterians, Methodists, Lutherans, any other and every other denomination, Philippians 5 in Memphis. I just love picking on them, don't I? They love to just throw us all together. But they're not, they don't meet that, those other groups don't meet the identification marks. It's not about that we think that we're the only ones going to heaven. I've already dispelled that whole notion, because look at babies that have committed no sin, babies that have been aborted. Look at people that were born with mental defect, mental illness where they cannot understand right from wrong. Those in the Old Testament of the patriarchal age that obeyed God. Abraham wasn't a Christian. Neither was David. He lived in the Mosaical time period. That soda this morning. I already dispelled that number real quick. I've done that several years ago. You remember that. I can think of at least of, you know, you have those in the patriarchal age, Old Testament, Mosaical age, Old Testament. I mentioned people who have mental illness and babies. That's at least four groups separate to Christians that are, guess what? They're going to be in heaven. It's not about us being the only ones going to heaven. It's about exclusivity. It's about obeying God in the New Testament and exclusivity. You know, I'm going to tell you, I'm about to hit something hard. People say the Church of Christ doesn't have a name. Oh, we have a name. We have a name. You know what the name is? Christ. Christian, basically. Why is that? Oh, I don't know. Because when you get married, you take on the name of your spouse. We are the bride of Christ. He is the groom. We take his last name. Well, not, and of course Christ is not his last name. That's a title. It means anointed one, means Messiah. But it's like but just as Brittany takes my last name, we take Christ's name. We take Jesus' name. And if the church is supposed to take Jesus' name, I just love it. I love that I never thought I would say this, but I love that the denominations have done something. The Pentecostals, the Baptists, the Presbyterians, the Methodists, the Lutherans, the Philippians 5. I love what they've done. And the reason why I'm saying that, the Catholics, I mean, we have a list right here that I have typed out here with my notes. There's a lot more denominations than that, but I love it. They've done something for me. They've done something for me. I'm talking about the exclusive claims that we have, being the bride of Christ, to Christ. The same way that Brittany has exclusive rights being my wife, and I'm just using her as a great example here because of the whole marriage situation, and the whole marriage example here. When she signs her name, she doesn't sign Brittany Heathcock anymore. She signs Brittany Langford. Why? Because she's my wife. So if these denominations claim to love Christ so much, they claim to love Jesus so much, why are they ashamed of his name? What name do they go by? Baptists, Presbyterians, Methodists, Lutherans, Pentecostals. The list goes on and on and on. We're going through a book here in Bible class, Traditions of Men versus the Word of God. That gives a pretty good long list. And while it's true that not every congregation out there, not every group out there meeting that puts Church of Christ on their building is following what Jesus said to do. Any group that's doing what Jesus said is going to be part of the bride of Christ. Now, before we move on, I want to take one quick moment to say something real fast. Context, context, context. Remember last week we said about keeping the context. When taken out of context, one can make it look like, it sounds like I said that I believe in the lesser gods, that they exist alongside the one true God, and that they're equal, when in fact that is not what I taught. But moving on into verse 12. And Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, took a burnt offering and sacrifices for God, and Aaron came, and all the elders of Israel, to eat bread with Moses, father-in-law before God. And it came to pass on the morrow that Moses sat to judge the people, and the people stood by Moses from the morning until the evening. So Moses is sitting here to, when he says he's judging them, he's not judging them, it's they're coming to him with their squabbles, with their civil suits. Somebody was like, oh, my neighbor cut my tent or something like that, or broke my wagon wheel. And Moses is sitting there and he's judging, he's being a judge, like in court. And they're there from the morning into the evening. And Moses' father-in-law, verse 14, saw all that he did to the people. And he said, what is this thing that thou doest to the people? Why sittest thou thyself alone, and all the people stand by thee from morning unto even? And Moses said unto his father-in-law, because the people come unto me to inquire of God. And they have a matter. When they have a matter, they come to me, and I judge between one and another, and I do make them know the statutes of God and his laws. And Moses' father-in-law said unto him, the thing that thou doest is not good. Thou wilt surely wear away both thou and this people that is with thee, for this thing is too heavy for thee. Thou art not able to perform it thyself alone. What the people have here is an anarcho-theocratic style government, if I could call it anything. And yes, God is over them all, but there are no levels of government. It's just Moses being there, leading the people, trying to do all the work himself to follow God's commands and mediate between people that have issues. Moses is basically doing everything himself. And Jethro sees this and gives him some advice. If he keeps doing this, he's going to wear himself out, drive himself crazy. If he keeps trying to do this all by himself, it's going to just wear him out. So verse 19, he says, hearken now unto my voice, or listen to my voice. I will give thee counsel, and God shall be with thee. Be thou for the people to Godward, that thou mayest bring the causes up unto God. And thou shalt teach them ordinances and laws, and shalt show them the way wherein they must walk, and the work they must do. Moreover, thou shalt provide out of all the people able men, such as fear God, men of truth, hating covetousness, and so there's qualifications there, and place such over them to be rulers of thousands, and rulers of hundreds, rulers of fifties, and rulers of tens. And let them judge the people at all seasons, and it shall be that with every great matter they shall bring it unto thee. But every small matter they shall judge, so it shall be easier for thyself, and they shall bear the burden with thee. If thou shalt do this thing, and God command thee so, then thou shalt be able to endure, and all this people shall also go to their place in peace. So Jethro, essentially, he advocates for different levels of government, or rulers, and for them to know and enforce what God has told Moses. These are supposed to be upright men. They're supposed to hate covetous. They're supposed to love truth, men of truth. And they have rulers over tens, then 50s, then hundreds, then thousands, finally up to Moses. And we have this same idea with our own systems of government, I say systems of government, in this country. We have our local governments, we have state governments, we have local city governments, we have county governments, we have state governments, and we have the national governments. We have the lesser courts. Like the homosexuals, they recently tried to sue a florist. And the local court sided with the homosexuals, so she took it up to the state and to the county courts. The county courts sided with her, with them. And then she's taking it on up to the Supreme Court. And hopefully the Supreme Court will side with her. But she's taking it up the chain of command. In our military, you have different men, different ranks that are over different groups, different sizes of different groups, even. And so we have this same idea with our own governmental systems here in this country. And decisions can sometimes be appealed to a higher authority if necessary. And Jesus also has a chain of command, believe it or not. If there's a controversy or disagreement, the exact term is if your brother sins against you or wrongs you, you take it to your brother. And if he won't, and you discuss it out in private, and if he won't hear you, you take it before two or three witnesses. If he won't hear them, you take it before the church. And then if he won't hear them, you withdraw fellowship. You have hierarchy systems within the home. Children, the mother is over the children, the husband is over the mother, and God is over the home. You have elders that, while we don't have a governmental authority on earth singularly over the church, you have elders over congregations. They have authority over congregations and non-spiritual law matters. The Bible governs all, of course. But then above them are the apostles that are currently in paradise. And then above the apostles, you have the king himself. So we have different levels of authority throughout the Old Testament, throughout the New Testament, all over the place. And that is simply because that government is not... Government is neither, whether government's big or small, is irrelevant. It's neither bad nor good. It's a tool that, when used properly, can be great good. When misused, it's very, very harmful. Then verse 24, so Moses hearkened to the voice of his father-in-law, did all that he had said. And Moses chose able men out of all Israel and made them heads over the people, rulers of thousands, rulers of hundreds, rulers of fifties, and rulers of tens. And they judged the people at all seasons, the hard causes they brought unto Moses, but every small matter they judged themselves. And Moses let his father-in-law depart, and he went his way into his own land. So Moses listened to the wisdom of Jethro, and it worked out for the best. Now, while it was sad to see him go, Jethro did have to go back to his own land. He had his own people to tend for. And Moses still has to lead the Israelites to their land. But that is for the future. We talked a lot about the exclusivity of the church. We talked about the exclusivity of the bride of Christ. There's identification marks. We talked about some of the identification marks. There's several identification marks, and the identification marks are found in only one place, and that is in the Bible. But then there is a... Now here's the beautiful thing is anyone can become a part of the bride of Christ. But it takes submission. It takes a whole lot of submission. First, you have to hear the word proclaimed, Romans 10:17. You have to believe that Jesus is who He said He is. We talked about it in the... That's John 8:24. But we talked about the church bringing the bride of Christ. If Brittany didn't believe that I am who I say I am, then she wouldn't have walked down that aisle to say I do. But then there's repentance. We notice that in talking about the exclusivity of God. But we have to repent of our sins. Acts 17:30. Then there is confessing allegiance to Him. Confessing fidelity to Christ before others. Romans 10:9-10. And then there's baptism. Romans 6:3-4. A burial. We are buried with Him in baptism. And then we rise up new creature. We rise up part of the bride of Christ. But then we have to live faithful. We have to live faithful unto death. If someone messes up, then they can observe God's second law of pardon, as Simon, once known as the sorcerer, did in Acts chapter 8. If anyone has need to respond to the Lord's invitation to become a Christian, become part of the bride of Christ. Yes, I'm very hard on the denominations. I'm very hard on them. I'm hard on them because God is a jealous God. Jesus is a jealous husband. And as part of the bride of Christ, I'm a jealous spouse to the bride of Christ. I'm a jealous spouse. A jealous bride. And please, I hope the homosexuals don't take that the wrong way. Seriously, we are the bride of Christ. We have a right to be jealous. We're jealous of any group that would seek to usurp our claims. Illegitimate groups that would seek to usurp our claims. But the thing is, a person can become part of the bride of Christ. Anyone can become part of the bride of Christ. There's a Baptist church, a Baptist denomination. I don't want to call them a church because that would imply that they are a bride. But there's a Baptist denomination right down the road from us. As they are right now, they have no valid claim to be the bride of Christ. But if they repented of their sins, and are baptized into Christ, live faithful, then guess what? They're no longer illegitimate. They're part of the bride of Christ. If they do those things, and if they live faithfully. That's the point, is that until that you are part of the bride of Christ, any claims of being part of the bride of Christ are illegitimate. But anyone can become part of the bride of Christ if they are willing to follow God. If they're willing to obey His commandments. If anyone has need to respond to the Lord's invitation, we beg with you, we plead with you, and encourage you to do so while the rest of us stand and sing. Please do so before it's everlastingly too late.